We're grateful for that all of you have been able to be here. And we welcome those on live stream. We're all safe, those of you on live stream. If you perhaps have wondered about it, we're all safe and appreciate your prayers. This will be our 30th exposition of the Gospel of John. We're going to be in John 3, verses 7 and 8. Jesus has introduced a requirement to Nicodemus with which he was not familiar. You must be born again. It was more, apparently, than his intellect could process, and it appears as though this is still very difficult for people to accept. They know how to say the words born again, but they, I mean, it's glaringly obvious that people do not know, as a rule, church people, what that means or what it involves. It remains very difficult for professing Christians to accept this. It's easier for them to accept a condition of human weakness and failings. They can accept that pretty easily. But this is a difficult thing for them to accept. That's why we hear expressions like this. We're only human.
Yeah.
No one's perfect. God accepts us as we are, warts and all. The only difference between us and the world is we're forgiven. You can't teach an old dog new tricks. Statistics confirm that those who are not saved by the time they're 12 are less likely to be converted. There's a whole plethora of sayings like this, but these are all sayings that are prompted by not knowing you must be born again. The 20th century way of saying, all of these sayings are the 20th century way of saying, how can a man be born when he's old? See, at least Nicodemus got straight to the point, but all these statements are the same way of saying that. Now, if it is true that Jesus is the truth and that he is the faithful witness, Jesus cannot lie.
Amen.
It isn't that he doesn't lie. He cannot lie.
Amen.
He cannot exaggerate, overstate, prevaricate, misrepresent, falsify, understate, overstate. See, he can't do this.
Amen.
So what Jesus says is not that you'll have difficulty thinking it's too big, it's that your difficulty thinking it's too small. There's no such thing as Jesus saying something that's, quote, too big. If Jesus isn't telling the truth here, then there's no hope of anybody being saved. Salvation is just a theory. It's all it is. It's not real at all. Why is that so? Because salvation and everything about it hangs on the veracity of God's word. If Jesus didn't speak the truth, we just as well throw the scriptures away, throw up our hands, eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we die. There isn't any hope. And you might not be surprised how many people think just as though what Jesus said isn't true. They approach life just as though this wasn't true. But it is true. See, with Nicodemus, he'd been taught to think in a non-God-centered way. That's how the Pharisees, they thought God wasn't at the center of their thoughts. He was out here on the emergency area somewhere. And so as soon as you begin to think, it's not God-centered, it's problem-centered. So you look at the world and say, man, look at all that stuff out there that's happening. We're in a dangerous... See, you begin thinking like that without God at the center, then God clouds your mind. He will not even let you see the truth. He won't allow it. The best way, does he? Just you must be born again. Yeah, that situation can't be resolved unless the person's born again. In the, particularly in the recent years, well, it's not just recent, it started rather early, where there's been theological and religious thinking that's not God-centered, it has accentuated human impotence. Now here's what happens. When people are taught things that aren't true, it makes it harder to believe the word of God, to believe on Christ. See, it makes it more difficult. Amen. If the teaching is skewed, you've handicapped the people that listen to it. It isn't that they'll overcome it. Oh, they won't overcome it if they keep listening to it. You can't overcome what you keep listening to. I think in our city there's just a handful of people that know that. Because some churches are filled up and they're not hearing very much at all. And it's not confined to this area. I mention this because this is supposedly the Bible Belt. When Israel was under the leadership of false prophets and evil priests, they went astray.
That's right. Yep.
And when God accounted for them going astray, that's how he accounted for it. It was their leaders. Their leaders. People are scared to say this today. They're afraid to say that the church has went askew because of the ones that are leading it.
Amen.
That's what the trouble is.
Yeah,
it's the leaders. What we've got, as unsavory as it is what the preachers and teachers have produced.
Yeah, that's right.
This is their fruit.
Yeah.
And I don't like it, and I don't think God does either. Now, I'm saying that because Nicodemus, he was a victim of that system himself. But there was something in him that refused to just stay in that situation. All right, John 3:7-8. Marvel not, I say, marvel not that I said unto thee, ye must be born again. The wind bloweth where it listeth, and thou hearest the sound thereof, but canst not tell whence it cometh or whither it goeth. So is everyone that's born of the Spirit. Marvel not. Some other verse. That's not, try not to marvel. I mean, that isn't what he said. Other verses say, don't marvel. How's this one? You should not be surprised. Do not, this is Jesus talking now. Do not be astonished. Stop being amazed. Do not wonder, never wonder. Thou mayest not wonder, and marvel not. Do not be surprised and astonished. See, this is the word of Jesus. When Jesus speaks, marveling or being astonished or being amazed are not accepted. They're just not accepted, that's all. Someone said, well, that's hard to believe. Well, you better be doing some, you better address that. You better address that matter. If that's hard to believe, you better be working on that then. Because Jesus says, don't be amazed. Don't be astonished. A person must recover from that state before the truth can be known. 16 times in Scripture, people were said to have marveled at what Jesus said. 15 times they were astonished. It's reported they were astonished, and 8 times they wondered. Now, all of these things occurred because what Jesus said was in stark contrast to everything else that had been said. It was like different. It wasn't the same gender, we might say, at all. So that's what caught. In other words, they were wed to the other things. The other things that the word of Jesus contradicted were the things that were dictating what they thought and how they thought. And so here comes Jesus. It's a gigantic interruption into the way they thought. They were amazed. They never likened Jesus to someone that was contemporary. Some people thought he was John the Baptist come back from the dead, or maybe one of the prophets that died, but nobody thought he was like somebody that was living. Jesus didn't remind them of anybody else, any other man. He didn't remind them of any living person that was there. He taught them, the scripture says, as one having authority, and not as the scribe. Not. Yeah, you've probably noticed this. There are people that speak with authority and not as the, whatever you choose to call them, but professionals. Mm-hmm. They don't speak that way. Religious professionals, it doesn't make a difference, north, south, east, west. They have a certain way of talking. It doesn't make a difference whether they're books or their recordings or their videos. It doesn't make any difference. All religious professionals have a certain tone. Doesn't mean everything they say is bad. That's not what I'm saying. But everything they say has this tone. There are some people that have risen above it, but they were probably ostracized by the people. See, Jesus said, except a man be born again, he can't see the kingdom of God. That's the statement he made. It was hard for Nicodemus and others to receive. See, Daniel had told about a time God was going to set up a kingdom, and it would break in pieces all other kingdoms. Now, it seems like how could that go like unnoticed? This is the way they're thinking. When the kingdom comes, I mean, everybody's going to know. Going to break in pieces all other kingdoms. And I think to some degree it will be noticed, but it evidently won't be universally noticed. His disciples one time, after they'd been with him for a while, he calmed a storm and said, what manner of man is this? See? I'm showing you the stranglehold that carnal thinking can have on a person. Here's the Son of God, stills a storm, makes the wind stop and the waves stop rolling. And instead of saying, thank God Jesus was with us, they say, what kind of man is this? See? It's hard to break out of carnality. Don't think for a moment it isn't. It's very difficult to break the stranglehold of carnality. So Jesus forbids Nicodemus to marvel, to be surprised or amazed or wonder. See, marveling belongs to the equation of unbelief. It's like a relative of unbelief. On another occasion, when Jesus spoke of raising the dead, he said, don't marvel at this. Yes, Sister Sydney.
Yeah.
That's good. God, I should always expect much.
That's good. Amen. That's good, Sister Sydney. That's good. Jesus, he spoke of the raising of the dead. He said, and he speaks spiritually raising the dead. I mean, do you believe that Jesus can raise the dead, the spiritually dead?
Uh-huh. Yes.
He says, the hour is coming, the Son of Man, they hear his voice, shall live. Then he told him, Don't marvel at this, for the hour is coming in which all that are in the graves will hear the voice of the Son of Man and come forth. He said, but people do marvel at this.
Oh, yes.
Church people do marvel at this. They marvel if you actually expect the people to be changed. Causes marvel, causes talk.
That's right.
What do you think people come up with programs for?
Yeah, that's right.
Why do you think they do?
Because
they have a deep-seated concern for people? I don't believe it. Because they don't believe. That's why. They don't know about this.
Yes.
They that hear his voice will come forth. Marveling. John, he picked up the same kind of language. John used the same kind of language. He said, marvel not, my brethren, if the world hates you.
Yeah.
So don't come to the assembly and gripe around because someone talked against you or criticized you or didn't like you. So what? Marvel not. That's what he said.
Yeah.
What do you expect the world to beat a path to your door? And they say, oh, we like you. We're glad you think they're going to do this. Marvel not.
Yeah.
So if you want to talk about that's in the imperative mode, as the language nuts say, that's in the imperative mode. Marvel. It's a command. Marvel not.
Yeah.
So if you've marveled, then it's to stop marveling.
Yeah. Amen.
Jesus also referred to a couple of sisters of Miss Marvel. And the sisters were fear and trouble. He said, be not afraid. Huh?
Yeah.
You ever been afraid?
Yes.
Be not afraid. That's what he said.
Yeah, amen.
It's Matthew 14:27 and several other places. Said, be not afraid. Or, be ye not troubled. Oh, yeah, I'm kind of hyper. You probably didn't know that, but I am. And once in a while, I get agitated and troubled. And when I'm troubled, I'm troubled. Then when I'm able to sit on, it's just like I can hear the Lord say, don't be troubled.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Oh, yeah, you get your spirit toned down, get it.
Amen.
Quieted down, you'll hear it say, don't be troubled.
Yes.
That's what he said, be not troubled. Now, another thing that's akin to being amazed, astonished, marveling, fearful, troubled, another is stagger. Staggered. That's in the same category. It said of Israel that they staggered, but not with strong drink. That's Isaiah 29:9. They staggered, but not with strong drink. See? In other words, what God said to them knocked them off and knocked them all out of balance. Now, by contrast, it says Abraham staggered not.
Yeah, that's right. See? Amen. Yeah.
Now, he received a pretty an illogical word. But he staggered not through unbelief at the promise of God, but strong in faith, giving glory to God. Now, viewed from another perspective, when we talk about amazed, astonished, marveled, amazed, and this sort of thing, from another perspective, this is stumbling. Jesus is either a stepping stone or a stumbling stone. Either people come up or they fall down. I mean, there's no neutral ground, brother. There's nothing in between.
Amen.
Just he's a foundation or a stumbling stone and a rock of offense. That's what he's called. Whoever believes in him will not be ashamed. Everybody else will.
Yeah.
So believing on him, that's tied to being born again. See, not marveling, not being astonished, not being amazed, not being fearful, not being troubled, not stumbling. That's all on the born again side.
Yeah, amen.
Man, you must be born again because you can't refrain from all those things unless you're born again.
That's right.
A powerless form of religion is one that promotes marveling.
Yes.
Now, if you've had the unfortunate experience of being in a powerless church. Whenever anything extraordinary happened, the people always marveled. And some people wouldn't believe what you said. Thought maybe you exaggerated. See? That's because a powerless religion promotes marveling, astonishment, amazement, staggering, fearful, troubled. It promotes all that sort of thing. So if it's true, and I think it is, as some have prayed tonight, that something's afoot in the world right now. Maybe bowls are being poured out of the wrath, but something's afoot. But if a person insists on sticking around where the folk are dead, this stuff is going to scare them. God's not going to comfort people now that settle for a diminutive religion. Don't kid yourself about this. God's good. God's gracious. God's merciful, but he's not going to hold up on his feet a person who insists on subjecting himself to something that's powerless. You were kept by the power of God through faith.
Amen.
And faith cannot be nurtured by error and misconception and being off-center. This doesn't contribute to faith at all. The things of the Spirit of God are foolishness to the natural man. He can't receive them. That's what causes a person to marvel. They're outside the scope of human experience. See, they got outside. See, some people, to preach effectively, they've got to liken things to baseball or football or Super Bowl or, they got to speak in that kind of language. But what they don't know is when they do, they've hid the truth.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Amen.
That just simply isn't. Why not? Because truth is outside the scope of baseball and football and so forth. It's in a domain those things can't get into. So if it's like you're out here in the holy place and you're likening stuff to the outer court. It doesn't work. Well, worse yet, outside the outer court. It doesn't work. So therefore, Jesus says to Nicodemus, marvel not that I said to thee, ye must be born again. That carries the same weight as when Jesus was confronting Jairus. Jairus had told him his daughter was dying, and so forth. And while he's speaking to Jesus, someone comes from Jairus' house and says to him, thy daughter is dead. Why trouble thou the master any further? You know what Jesus said?
Yeah.
He said, marvel not. Well, he said it this way. Be not afraid, only believe. See, that's a breakdown of marvel not. Now, there's a great need for this today. See, men must be wooed away, so to speak, from carnal responses. See, the antidote to marveling and wondering is believing. That's the antidote. So men are strong in faith if they give glory to God. Yes, Brother Jason.
We have to think, too, this is a particular word to Nicodemus who was in a position where he should have known. Nicodemus was a teacher of Israel. Jesus said, you're a teacher of Israel, and you don't understand these things.
That's right.
And Jesus often he rebuked his disciples because they had been with him and had seen him do miracles, but they failed to believe.
Like
that time he asked them the questions, when I multiply the loaves, how many baskets did you pick up now? Tell me about that again. 12. Do you still not understand? See, they had this prior experience and revelation. So the principle to take away from this is that unbelief, see, there are some people that they don't believe because they've never heard anything. There are other people who have heard and seen, and this is particularly unacceptable.
That's right. Very
and
good.
I think this is what, this principle applies across the board. Unbelief is always wrong, but particularly for someone like Nicodemus.
That's right. That's exactly
to not believe.
That's exactly
is bad.
It.
Amen.
That's exactly it. There was enough evidence he should have produced this, pursued this. Uh-huh. That's right. Well, that had some far-reaching implications, doesn't it? Marvel not. Marvel not that I said, that I said unto thee. Now, Jesus referred to his own words in this way. I said. That's 16 times he said that. As I said. I said unto thee. I'm pointing out that Jesus draws attention to what he said. I said unto you. I said it. As I said. How I said. These things I said. What I said. See? Over and over. And in the Gospels, Jesus said, I say. 147 times. I say. He didn't say I do. He said I say. He also said that he mentioned my words 11 times. My words. He never told you what someone else said unless it was someone God spoke through. He declared the person who loved him would keep his words. He said if someone was ashamed of his words, he'd be ashamed of them in the day of judgment. Uh-huh. Marvel not what I said. Mm-hmm. What I said. Don't marvel at that. Then he says, ye must. Marvel not that I said, ye must. See, that's a saying that people that are self-seeking and self-indulging, they don't like. They don't like language like that. A person is judged upon the basis of what his response to what Jesus said. And Jesus, he says this too much. You must. He says that too much to be ignored. For example, he said about new wine, it must be put in new bottles. New wine must be put in new bottles. He affirmed that hearing wars and rumors of wars must be. You're going to have to hear about this. So when you hear about this, don't stumble. This must be. This must be. He said, they that worship God must worship him in spirit and truth. It's got to be done. Jesus talked. I'll comment more about these words. From Acts to Revelation, the word must is mentioned 47 times. Must. It's the word of a sovereign. See, a sovereign says this, you must.
Amen.
God never says try.
Mm-hmm.
God never says do your best.
Yeah.
He says must. Mm-hmm. Must is the word of a sovereign.
Mm-hmm.
Men must conform to God's will rather than seeking God to conform to their will.
Amen.
We never say to God, you must. He says to us, you must.
Amen.
You must. Jesus set the standard for us on this matter.
Yeah.
He said, they like, I must be about my Father's business. See? Say, we're not under law. You don't have to do it. Jesus said, I must.
Yeah. Amen.
You can call it whatever you want to call it. I must be about my Father's business. He said, I must preach the kingdom of God. I must.
Mm-hmm.
See, this is telling you there's a higher authority that dictates what you do.
Amen. Yep.
Mm. I must walk today.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, Jason.
There's a couple of ways of looking at law. You just brought that up.
Mm-hmm.
Some people will say, well, we're not under law. There's a couple of ways of looking at law, though. There's law as in like commandment, like do what I say because I'm in charge. That is one kind of law.
Yeah.
And God does do that.
Mm-hmm.
Now, but there's another kind of law too. A law like a principle. Like, this is the way things are.
That's
like
right.
The law of gravity.
That's
now, there's
right.
Nobody sitting around telling us about the law of gravity. It's just the way things are.
Yes.
It's a principle. It's the nature of the order of things.
That's right.
So
right.
That could, you could understand what Jesus is saying that way, too. It's not not that he's just saying this arbitrarily. Just, you must. Why? Well, because I said so. Although he can do that, he's saying this is just the nature of things.
Yeah, if you want to be involved, this is what has to happen.
Yeah, yeah. That's right.
Yeah.
This kind of must is like a compelling inner power.
Yes. Yeah.
Power within.
That's good. Yeah.
Yeah.
I must work the works of him that sent me.
Yeah.
Yeah, it wasn't, I got this mandate and I got to do this. He was driven to compel from within.
Right. Yeah. Amen.
Other sheep if I have, they're not of this fold, them I must bring. I must, see? He's compelled. In referring to his sacrifice, he said, the Son of Man must suffer many things. The Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of men. Even so must the Son of Man be lifted up. See, he's operated in this agenda that Brother Jason was talking about. He must be born again. It's in that divine agenda. It's more than just a stipulation. It goes beyond that. The reason you must be born again is because God has totally rejected Adam.
Amen.
So Adam, what comes from Adam, Adam's progeny, it's not, none of it is accepted.
That's right.
He just rejected it all. Mm-hmm. One sin, one time, and all were made sinners, all were condemned.
Yep.
See? That's what Romans 5 teaches.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
One sin, one man, one sin, one time, the race is cut off.
That's right.
Yeah. So that's why you have to be born again. Mm-hmm. It isn't that you've done a lot of bad things and you've got to start over. But this is how most religious people see it. You've done your share of bad things. It's about time to change. That's not what this is saying.
Yeah, amen. Uh-huh.
If you hadn't done any bad things as the world counts bad, you still have to be born again.
Yes, amen.
So this kind of language, you must be born again. It speaks of divine purpose, see? Determination, revelation, as opposed to human reasoning.
Yeah.
This is talking about divine government that's on Christ's shoulder.
Yes.
And it's a standard to which men are held without any deviation.
Mm-hmm.
At all. You must be born again. By using the expression born again, the accent's placed on what God does.
Yeah.
You can see that.
Yeah.
You can see that. You're not the one that does the birthing.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Man cannot be the primary person in being born again.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. He's acted upon.
Mm-hmm.
Even as Nicodemus recognized, can he enter the second time to see? He understood this, that this is something, how can it be done?
Mm-hmm.
So far as our generation is concerned, when a falling away came, something that happened was the accent on God, Christ, and the Spirit was removed. That's what happened. Some of the great reformers, just a handful of them, that's the very thing they sought to reawaken, the centrality of God and Christ and the Holy Spirit. See, because that was lost at the falling away. This was lost, and so consequent that new birth was toned. As soon as you're not thinking about the work of God or the work of Christ or the work of the Holy Spirit, you begin to theorize about being born again.
Yeah.
But since they say it must be born again, I come from a background, that's not what they said. They said you've got to be baptized.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
That's what they said. And there's other groups, they have their thing too, they say. Yes.
Yeah, I think the contrast is between the natural birth and a supernatural
birth.
That's
right. Mm-hmm.
So obviously you were born naturally. You're, mm-hmm. you were born of your father's seed, your
yeah.
mother's
yeah.
The DNA mixing together. You were born. That's the natural birth. Now you have to have a supernatural
birth. That's right.
So something yeah, something yeah. supernatural has to get into you.
That's right. Uh-huh.
Something from outside
Amen.
Nature
Amen.
Has to get into man.
He's going to stress there has to be, just like with a natural birth, there has to be an observable beginning. The different birth has to have an observable, or how do you know it's occurred if it doesn't? You can't just theorize about it. In the new birth, the old things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. That's observable to the person who's been born again, that this will become observable. Maybe someone has to articulate this so he can kind of put it together. And he says, yeah, as a matter of fact, my preferences, they have changed. This is true. See, that's what being born again involves. The person is delivered from the power of darkness. So Satan can't maintain a hold on a person who's been delivered. But the person himself has to know that. Because we're kept by the power of God through faith, see? Jesus makes you free indeed. That means it can be assessed.
That's right. Amen.
It can be diagnosed. Mm-hmm. It can be perceived. Sometimes it takes a lifetime. Years and years and years will pass, and you're still seeing how you've been delivered from something that you knew held you for a long. Maybe it was a wrong idea.
Right.
Maybe it wasn't like a particular act of immorality. Like the natural birth, the new birth is accompanied by undeniable mm-hmm. evidences. Now, John puts it this way. If ye know that he is righteous, ye know that everyone that doeth righteousness is born of him. So there's one of the tests. But you have to know he's righteous, or else you can't tell who else is righteous. See, if you don't know Jesus is righteous, you don't know if anybody's righteous. If you know he's righteous, you know that anyone that does righteousness
Amen.
Is righteous. He's not righteous because he does righteousness. He does righteousness because he is righteous.
Yes.
See, God made him righteous. Mm-hmm. That's what Romans 5:19 says. Whosoever is born of God doth not commit sin. For his seed remaineth in him, and he cannot sin because he's born of God. Someone says, what that means is he doesn't continue. Well, yeah, if you're talking about he sin, he didn't continue. All right, But if you mean from now on sin is the exception, he'll sin a little bit, but it's not what born of God isn't what sinned.
That's right. Amen.
If it is, then what's born of God is no different than Adam.
That's right. Yep.
Then, if that's true, then the new creation is really just like starting all over with Adam.
Uh-huh. Yep.
But the new creation can't sin. But you've got to live in the power
Amen.
Of the new creation.
Yes.
See? Yep. You've got another walk in the Spirit,
Amen.
Or live by
Amen.
Faith,
yep.
have fellowship with Christ.
Yes.
This is, and if you walk in the Spirit, you will not
yes.
fulfill the lust of the flesh. That's Romans 5:16. You won't.
That's right.
Not you shouldn't. You won't.
Mm-hmm.
But you know you can assess yourself, and you'll be able to say, I need to improve in this area.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, Brother Jason.
Jesus himself was a living example of what this new birth is, because Christ was a union
that's right.
of something human and something
yeah.
divine.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
That's right.
And that's what believers have to become.
That's right.
See, he's the first of a new race.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
He's the union of God and
mm-hmm.
man.
That's right.
And that's what believers are becoming when they experience
Amen.
This new birth.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Mm-hmm.
Now, people sometimes they get how do we know these things and all this? One of the advantages of fellowship with God's people is it makes this easier to detect and to maintain.
Yeah.
But if you can't find kindred spirits, mm-hmm. you will have trouble with this. Mm-hmm. Not because you're sinful, but because this is how spiritual life mm-hmm. is in the context of other people that yeah. are born again, and it will awaken. It will keep you from falling away. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes, if you're exiled in the Isle of Patmos, another matter. If your circumstances are such that cannot be resolved, mm-hmm. then God will make you stand. He yeah. can enter into the yeah. situation. But under the ordinary circumstances, mm-hmm. fellowship with kindred spirits yeah. helps the people yeah. to keep aware of this, uh-huh. whatsoever is born of God sinneth yeah. not. And we expect, when you believe the truth, we expect you not to sin.
Yeah, that's right.
Whether you see it in me or I see it in you, we're yeah. disappointed when we see professing Amen. Believers Amen. Sin. We're not standing to condemn them, but we're yeah. disappointed.
Amen.
Disappointed to see it.
Yeah, I like it the way you put it. They're not known for sin.
That's right.
Amen.
It's an exception.
Yeah.
Now, as I have mentioned to you, that the new birth, like the natural birth, is accompanied by evidences. By this we know that we love the children of God, and we love God and keep His commandments.
Yeah.
That's how you know they love the children of God. Mm-hmm. That isn't how men would say it.
Uh-huh.
They say, by this we know that we love God and keep His commandments. By this we know we love the children of God if we love God and keep His commandments. That's not the way men would say it. They say, we know that we love God and keep His commandments by loving the brethren.
Mm-hmm.
See, it's a different way of reasoning. Now, if yeah. you love God
uh-huh.
and you keep His commandments, you can't hate
yeah.
God's people.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
It can't be done.
Uh-huh.
So we read of things that must be,
uh-huh.
we don't want to marvel.
Yes.
Now then Jesus provides a little explanation. He says, the wind bloweth where it listeth, and thou hearest the sound thereof, but canst not tell whence it cometh and whither it goeth. So is everyone that is born of the Spirit. Now he's gonna nail this down a little better for Nicodemus. This is not as plain as may immediately appear. The wind blows. You remember that God has employed wind on quite a number of occasions. So when he says this, that, remember there was when the brought locusts on the land of Egypt, God brought an east wind. The east wind brought the wind went where it wanted. It took the locusts and went to Egypt. Then a strong west wind took them out. Remember, the text says, the wind blows where it listeth. When Israel crossed the Red Sea, God sent a strong east wind that divided the waters, went where it wanted. When Pharaoh and his armies were in the midst of the sea, the Lord blew with his wind.
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
And the seas overcovered them over. When God sent quails to Israel, a wind from the Lord brought them in. When the Lord passed by Elijah on the mount, a great strong wind rent the mountain, broke the rocks. The day of Pentecost, there was a sound of a rushing mighty wind. All right, now Jesus said, the wind blows where it listeth. What does that mean, listeth?
Mm-hmm.
See. Some of the other version says, where it wishes. Maybe you thought that listeth is like listening. Huh? Maybe you thought he's talking about hearing. That's not what he's talking about. The wind blows where it wishes. NIV says, wherever it pleases. New Revised Standard says, where it chooses. Revised Standard says, where it wills.
Mm-hmm.
Basic Bible says, where its pleasure takes it, where it wants to. The word translated listeth has this lexical meaning. To be resolved or determined to purpose absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
The meaning is that men do not have any control over the wind. It goes wherever it wants. You cannot tell. You don't know where the wind's coming from, and you can't see where it's going. You cannot know ahead of time what it's going to do. If wind did not have a sound or some kind of visible evidence, you wouldn't know it was there. The only proof of a tornado or a cyclone is the sound of it and what it does. So is everyone born of the Spirit. What is he saying? You can't tell how a person is born again. That's his point. You don't know how this is done. There isn't a procedure that it does this.
Amen. That's right.
It's God that determines who's born again, and he's the one that does the whole thing.
Amen.
See,
amen.
He's born from above.
Amen.
You cannot tell. Some versions say it this way: so you can't explain how people are born of the Spirit. If you've ever tried. Have you ever tried to explain this? If you did, you weren't successful.
Yeah.
We do not know on whom he will will next bestow this life from heaven. That's a living Bible. That is the way with everyone who owes his birth to the Spirit. So it's not possible. How can a man be born when he's old? Jesus is saying to him, this is something God doesn't divulge. Otherwise, you could do the how. Of course, some people think that's how. This is how you. We have. I was exposed to a 5-step plan. Full gospel businessmen have a 6-step plan. Some members of the restoration movement have a 6-step plan too. But this isn't how people are born again.
Amen.
You ought to be able to conclude it by diagnosing the church members. It's not possible to explain how a person is born again. You can't plan for a new birth.
That's right.
No one can cause it to happen at all. When first explaining the conversion of the Gentiles at the house of Cornelius, Peter said, for as much as God gave them the like gift as he did us who believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, what was I that I could withstand God? He told you, now this is how it was done, folks. Just do what I did. This is how. He said, I got this evidence right before my eyes. They got the same gift we did at Pentecost. See, I was taught that only the apostles got that. But the group of men that were with Peter weren't apostles.
That's right.
But this same thing that happened to them, and they were baptized with the Holy Spirit, because that's the word that was remembered, the same thing that happened to the disciples of the day of Pentecost, the same thing happened to Cornelius a decade later.
Yeah.
They were not even Jewish.
That's right.
They were
either.
That's right. So I could withstand. The wind blew where it lit, where it wanted.
That's
this
right.
is what happened. The wind blew where it wanted. Peter saw. So who was I that could withstand God? Later, at their conference in Jerusalem, when they were discussing circumcision, Peter brought this up again. Well, let me mention how the early church responded when Peter made that statement. Who was I that I should withstand God? The people responded. They held their peace and glorified God, saying, then hath God also to the Gentiles granted repentance of life. The wind blew where it wanted. Can you see that? Later, when they had this conference, Peter mentioned this conversion at Cornelius' house again. He brought it up again. Peter rose up and said, Men and brethren, ye know how that a good while ago God made choice among us, see? That the Gentiles by my mouth should hear the word of the gospel and believe. And God which knoweth the hearts bear them witness, giving them the Holy Ghost, even as he did unto us, and put no difference between us and them, purifying their hearts by faith. The wind blew where it listed, it wanted. Yeah. Then James said, Simeon had declared how God at the first did visit the Gentiles and take out of them a people for his safety. The wind blew.
That's right.
The wind blew where it wanted. See?
Amen.
God did it.
That's
see?
Right.
That's how everybody knew it when they heard that. But listen, brethren, when reports of conversions are given, this is not the response of the people that hear them.
That's right.
If you think it is, study the thing out. I don't know how many reports, how thousands of reports I've read about conversions, but I never heard them say this.
That's right.
They didn't know. The wind blows where it wants and the Spirit goes where he wants.
That's right. Amen.
Amen.
That's right.
Where God sends him to go.
Uh-huh.
Who would have suspected after the Paul and company went all through that Galatia area, that whole area of the world, that a group of women in Macedonia gathered by a riverside would be the ones that were born again. Who would ever figure that out? Who would have figured out that a Philippian jailer, and his whole house would be born again? See, the wind blew over there. The wind blew over there into that prison. And then it blew over into the Philippian jailer's house, and he believed in the Lord Jesus Christ without having to be talked and counseled and all this.
Yeah.
Wind blew where it listed.
Yes.
So no, you can't plot out how people are born again.
Yes.
But you do need to be it does need to be preached. They must.
Yes.
They must be born again, which tells you that God is not apt to do this where this kind of sensitivity has not been somehow awakened. So these reports about Cornelius' household, these are reports of people being born again.
That's
what this was. This was people being born again. The report was given of what the Lord was pleased to do. Notice how they reported it. God did it. God sent the word. God poured out his Spirit upon them. See, God took out of people for his name. See, they saw, they knew this was the wind was blowing where it wanted.
Amen.
Oh, I got a lot out of that, I tell you.
Amen.
There are reports of the Holy Spirit moving about as he wills, convicting, begetting, implementing.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes they'd come back to Paul, he'd write about it. He heard about the wind blowing. He said, we heard about your faith and love which is in Christ Jesus. See, the wind blew over there.
He talked about the Thessalonians.
That's right.
Labor of love, steadfastness of hope.
Yeah.
They believed the word as the word of God, not as the word of men.
That's right. See, the wind blew there.
That's right.
And it was a short-term visit, but the wind blew there.
Exactly.
Boy, I tell you. See, it's all of God, and blessed is the persons are the persons who see it.
Amen.
That it's all of God.
Right.
If you're saved, it's because God saved you.
Amen. That's right.
You never want to forget God raised you. You never want to forget it. God quickened you. You don't want to forget it. God delivered you. You don't want to forget it. God justified you. God gave you the Holy Spirit. You don't want to forget it.
Yes.
God gave you everlasting hope and good consolation, everlasting consolation and good hope through grace. See, God did it.
Yes.
The wind blew where it listed. So how's a man born again? By the will of God.
Amen.
All right, any of you have something you'd like to add tonight? Yeah, Father.
After Jesus told Nicodemus not to marvel, the scripture says Jesus marveled two times.
Yeah.
One at unbelief and one at faith.
Uh-huh.
But I think the reasons that are very different, obviously. Nicodemus marveled at something that actually had been demonstrated.
Yeah.
That God doing something impossible.
Mm-hmm.
But Jesus
marveled by, or marveled at someone who had overcome, overcome odds, someone who had great faith,
yeah,
while he was, they were surrounded by great unbelief. And then he marveled at unbelief,
that's right,
because they didn't believe in the face of so much evidence,
yeah,
so much testimony, so much working. So they were, it was a different, I'd be interested in how you would contrast those.
Well, those things were, did Jesus consider those things as impossible as the others, mm-hmm, considered him? It violated all divine reasoning and all of the divine gifts, all of the work God had done, it violated it. Mm-hmm. He marveled because of it. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're right. Two things. One, at faith, mm-hmm, in the midst of a perverse generation. Here was a, wasn't a Jew either. That had great faith. He marveled and he had faith under those circumstances because it contradicted the norm.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And then he marveled at the unbelief,
mm-hmm,
after he had done so many miracles.
Yes. Yeah.
See, it contradicted, mm-hmm, sound reasoning.
Yes, amen.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, this whole text, and particularly this last phrase here about the wind blowing and the power of the Spirit, is again setting up a contrast and a comparison with the law, because Nicodemus, he kind of represents the best of that.
Yeah.
He's like the best of that old covenant order of things.
Right? Yeah.
And but he needed to be born again too.
That's right.
And so whatever this is, it's not law.
That's right.
You can't be born again by the law. The law never caused anybody to be born again.
Yeah.
Or religion. See, religion's impotent. Law is impotent. It has to be something. There has to be something else before a person can enter the kingdom.
See, when you, if you took command someone under the law to be washed,
mm-hmm,
there was a step-by-step procedure,
mm-hmm,
in what they were to do. But when you're washed from your sins, that's not the way it is.
Yeah.
In other words, God didn't do the washing of them.
Mm-hmm.
But when God does the washing, you cannot duplicate it. Yeah.
Amen.
That's why empty form is so wrong. See, can you see it? That's why it's so wrong. Yes, Brother Justin.
Yeah. About a week and a half ago, I was on my lunch hour. I felt led by the Spirit to preach the gospel in the break room. And before I knew it, I had a full audience packed in there. And after I got done preaching that this is the condemnation, that light's come into the world and that men love darkness rather than light because their deeds were evil, and I closed that point, everyone was silent. I mean, you could hear a pin drop,
mm-hmm,
and it was unusual for a break room. And I was just thinking, like, I just got done for 30 minutes preaching a gospel, and silence is what I get. You know, like, that's the response to the gospel,
yeah,
is silence.
Uh-huh.
But it makes perfect sense, because everyone was astonished, which is the 1828 definition of astonished is to be struck with sudden fear.
Yeah.
I remember seeing one of the guy's legs is shaking like this. And he's just sitting there, and he's so convicted, his leg's shaking. And that's why, because they were all marveling.
Yeah.
It's just like you said, their lifestyle, mm-hmm, and their residency of this world was in contradiction with,
yeah,
the things that I was saying.
Yeah. Yeah.
By contrast, a couple of weeks ago, after I was speaking, when I finished, Brother Tony said, "Don't stop, don't stop."
There you are.
Yeah.
Amen.
Evermore,
amen.
Give us this
plan. Yeah,
right.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's the difference, yeah.
That's right.
To whom shall we go?
Amen. Yeah, you got Peter. He looks out and he sees Jesus walking, and he doesn't, he's not marveling. He says, "If it's you, bid me to come."
That's right.
He leaped far above that marveling, and he wanted to go out there.
That's right.
Likely someone will come to Brother Justin and want to know more.
Yeah.
Likely.
The one man said, how do you know this? He goes, you know so much.
Mm.
I was just thinking, like, I don't really know that much. But to them, don't it was it, like, don't tell it was, they had never heard anything like that before.
Yeah.
Just tell them, I used to be ignorant like you.
Yeah.
You could say, I can't stop speaking of things I've heard.
Yeah. Cannot help but speak.
Yeah, that's right. That's right.
All right, we'll have a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we're grateful for the new birth. We just thank you and praise your name that there is such a thing as this, and that we've experienced it by your grace. We pray that we would have a lively awareness of this and produce fruits that will confirm that this is the case. Give us opportunity to bear witness to this fact that you must be born again and be able to answer wisely the responses of men. We commit this to you in Jesus' name. Amen.